So it's time for us to start the second session of the afternoon. So my name is Gang Chen. Following Subhro's suggestion, I'm going to chair this session. So I'm a professor of physics from Fudan University of China. So this session has two talks. The first talk is interface and lattice engineering of complex oxides. And the speaker is Srimanta Middey from Indian Institute of Science.
Thank you, Chairman. So first of all, I would like to thank Subhro for inviting me to this workshop. So today I'm going to talk about interface and lattice engineering of complex oxide. So I will show you some examples that how you can solve a long-standing problem of correlated oxides using interface. And then in the second part, I will show by this lattice engineering how you can also generate frustrated magnet. So first, I would like to acknowledge all of my collaborators. So most part of the work that I'm going to present was done when I was a postdoc in Jack Sakalian's group at University of Arkansas. Now he is at Rutgers. And I will show results from lots of synchrotron-based measurements. Those measurements I did in different national labs, like Brookhaven National Lab, Argonne National Lab, and Berkeley Lab. And at the last, I will show you some current work which my student is doing. His name is Hosan Kumar Oja. And funding comes from IIC Startup Grant and ISRO IIC Space Technology Center. So this is very basic of complex oxide. This is just for the students that transition metal oxides have variety of crystal structure. There are several competitive energy scales into the system like Coulomb interaction, bandwidth, Hoffing, Hund's coupling, crystal field splitting, etc. And also, there are strong intercoupling between the spin charge, lattice, and orbital degrees of freedom. And this class of materials show different kinds of behavior like metal insulator transition, superconductivity, charge ordering, orbital ordering, multiperiodicity, etc. So the other interesting aspects of these complex oxides that these kinds of properties are highly tunable. Suppose you synthesize some material in the bulk form, then you can do many things, like you can have chemical doping. So by doping, you can get new phenomena. Like this is well-known phase diagram for high TC cufrate. This is like phase diagram for manganites, and this is for vanadates. You don't have to go into the details of this phase diagram, but just see each of these color represents a different phase. So by tuning this doping, you can change completely the behavior of the material. Similarly, if you change the temperature along y-axis, you can also get a new phase. So it is very highly tunable, all of these phenomena. Similarly, you can put this material in external field like pressure, a magnetic field, light, and as a result of all of this, you can get new phenomena. So over the last 10-15 years, due to the virtue of rapid progress in thin film growth technologies, now one can make interface of these two different materials of these correlated oxides with unit cell precision and get new phenomena. Like when you grow some kind of heterostructures, so similar to this also, there are many different your control knob. So one of the things that when you form an interface, like this is an interface between two different material. So at the interface, across the interface, you can have a charge transfer. Similarly, you can have epitaxial strain. Like for the bulk, your pressure is always compressive, but strain can be tensile or compressive. Similarly, you can also study the effect of quantum confinement. Basically, you can reduce the thickness of the material to one unit cell, two unit cell in that limit, and you can see that because of the confinement, your properties are very different. And the most important thing is that when you form an interface, so across the interface, there are mismatch in different things, like the structures can be different, the lattice symmetry can be different, the orbital structure can be different, magnetic structure can be different, and as a result of all of this interfacial mismatch, this interface can gives rise to many emergent electronic and magnetic phenomena which are not available in these constituted bulk materials. So these are the couple of well-known examples, like if you form an interface between a band insulator strontium titanate and MOT insulator lanthanum titanate, the interface becomes highly metallic. This is another example that you can get ferromagnetism out of non-ferroic systems, like calcium manganite is an antiferromagnet and calcium ruthenite is a paramagnet, but when you form a heterostructures, it behaves like a ferromagnet. Similarly, you can get ferroelectricity out of non-ferroic components like lanthanum manganite, strontium manganite, neodymium manganite, individually, none of these materials are ferroelectric. But when you form an heterostructures, it shows ferroelectricity. So let's see how you can grow this kind of interface. So the method which I am using, basically, which we are using, is pulse laser deposition. So in this technique, basically, you have a very high energy laser. Basically, it's a UV laser. So in your system, you have some target. So this laser beam falls on the target and forms a flume. And that flume transfers the material from this target on top of the substrate, and you deposit the film. And during, so in this setup, we also have additional technique called REED, reflection, high energy electron diffraction. So by this technique, you can monitor the progress of your thin film growth, and actually you can control the thickness in unit cell precision. So basically, for a perovskite material, if you can monitor this intensity of this called specular spot, and that one oscillation corresponds to typical one unit cell. One unit cell means I am talking about length scale of 4 angstrom. So in that level, you can control the thickness of the material. So this is an example of a perovskite neodymium nickelate grown on neodymium chelate substrate. These are the Reed oscillations. And these are the STEM image, so showing very sharp interface between the substrate and between the film. So now, using this interface, so once we grow this interface, so we would like to understand the interfacial electronic and magnetic structure. So normal conventional technique will not, many of the technique doesn't work. So we are using various X-ray based technique to understand this interfacial phenomena, like starting from X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy to X-ray absorption spectroscopy and X-ray resonance scattering. So first part of my talk will be focused on, based on this paper, a recent paper. So this class of complex oxides also show simultaneous transition. For example, if you consider this called vanadium oxide FeO2, this is the resistivity as a function of temperature. So it has a transition from a metal phase and insulator phase, but there is also a simultaneous transition from a tetragonal phase to monoclinic phase. So there is a debate that whether this transition is controlled by the mod physics or it depends by the structure. Similarly, if you consider V2O3, there are three transitions together. Like one is electronic, metal to insulator, structure, and another is antiferromagnetism. So then the question is that, okay, among the three transitions, then which one is the primary transition? Which one is governing this observed electronic and magnetic phenomena? So these are the problems are currently have been addressed mostly using ultrafast experiment. So people have shown that using ultrafast experiment, like in femtosecond time scale, one can generate monoclinic metal phase. And from that, one can conclude that this structural transition is not necessary. Similarly, people have done also high pressure experiment. And in presence of very high pressure, they have also shown that you can get monoclinic metallic phase. So that means this structural phase transition is not necessary for getting the metal insulator transitions. But we have to remember that this monoclinic metal phase, you are getting only in the transient, as a transient phase. That is, if you remove the external field, this phase is no longer there. So we are interested whether we can generate this kind of unusual phase using a different, as a ground state, not in presence of external field. Okay, so for that, we consider this material called rare earth nickelate. So in rare earth nickelate also, this is the phase diagram as a function of basically this rare earth ion. So if you consider this part of the phase diagram, like for neodymium nickelate, it's here. So it undergoes four transitions together. So in this phase, it's a metal, it has orthorhombic structure, it is paramagnetic, and there is no charge already. So if you lower the temperature, so it becomes insulator, and together there are three more transitions. One is structural transition, one is magnetic transition, and another is also charge order transition. Yeah. These are for bulk samples. These are for bulk. So there are actually in the literature, there is a strong debate then what is the origin of these electronic transitions. Now, if you focus on this part of the phase diagram here, so in this, along this line, there are three transitions together. So here you have a metal insulator, structure, and charge ordering transition. And this phase and this both are paramagnetic. And if you cross this line, then you have another transition from paramagnetic to antiferromagnetic. So basically, this is a paramagnetic insulating phase, and this is an antiferromagnetic insulating phase. Okay. So there are many conflicting results in the from experimental point of view, which does not tell that what is the primary factor for these transitions. For example, if you think that the structural transition is responsible, then you have to remember that this monoclinic distortion is very small. It's the change of the bond angle is only 0.08 degree. So it's very difficult to believe that such small change in the bond angle will result in insulating phase. Similarly, if you consider that it is governed by the charge ordering, then there are some Newton diffraction measurement on neodymium nickelate showing that the magnetic moments is very similar. So this does not then matches with this charge ordering picture. Also, this value of delta for neodymium nickelate, it has been from experiment, it has been concluded that it is of the order of 0.45. But there are also later experiments showing that the delta, if I believe this is true, throughout the series is unchanged. However, if I go back to our phase diagram, you can see that metal insulator transition varies over a temperature scale of 600 Kelvin. But delta is same for all compounds, which is a little bit difficult to understand. So now if I believe that it is governed by electron correlation, basically Mott physics, then that there is no requirement of magnetic ordering, because Mott transition you can get from a paramagnet to paramagnet. You cannot explain why there is antiferromagnetic transition for neodymium nickelate. And also, if I think that my magnetic ordering is the main driving transitions, then also some experimental results is very difficult to explain. Like there are some high pressure experiments where people have claimed that there is signature of antiferromagnetism even in the metallic phase. So it's very difficult to pinpoint that what is the governing mechanism for this. So in recent, like last 5-6 years, there are many theoretical work which emphasizes that this charge ordering that is not necessary for having the metal insulator transitions. So we want to basically engineer this charge ordering, whether we can probe this thing in a different way. So this is basically the charge ordering pattern. So basically you have nickel 3 plus delta and nickel 3 minus delta alternating in all three directions. And this is commonly known as checkerboard type charge ordering. Okay, so questions we are asking that can we manipulate this charge ordering if I believe that charge ordering is there. So for this, we go back to this heterostructure route. So now what we have done, we have combined two different material, europium nickelate and lanthanum nickelate, into a heterostructure form. So we have considered two different structures. One is one unit cell of europium nickelate and one unit cell of lanthanum nickelate. It is and repeating in C direction. So basically, this is one layer of europium nickelate and this is one layer of lanthanum nickelate. Now, if you see this structure, each of this nickel is actually equivalent. Like each nickel, it has europium on one side and lanthanum on the another side. And on this structure, you can easily consider this kind of charge ordering, like nickel 3 plus delta and nickel 3 minus delta. Okay, so basically we are claiming that charge ordering will be compatible with this 1-1 structure. Now, if you look at this 2-1 structure, so now you have two unit cell of europium nickelate and one unit cell of lanthanum nickelate. Now, if you see, the periodicity of my structure is 3 unit cell, whereas the periodicity of my charge ordering is 2. So basically, what we guess at the beginning, that if I can make this structure, then this charge ordering will not be compatible, because that does not match with the periodicity of my crystal structure. So this was our initial idea. Then we grow the samples. I can skip the details of the growth, but if someone is interested, I can come back to this. Okay. So then we probe the charge ordering. So what is the technique to probe the charge ordering? So we are using this technique called resonant X-ray scattering to probe the charge ordering. So the basic is the following. So now if you calculate structure factor of certain kind of back reflection like H0L and 0KL, when HKL are odd, if you calculate the structure factor, that will be zero for an orthonormic symmetry. So in the metal phase, this bulk form, these are in orthonormic structure. So these kind of reflections are forbidden, But these things are allowed in a monoclinic symmetry. And secondly, one can do resonance scattering, basically an energy scan, to see whether that reflection is contributed by the nickel. So I will guide through that experimental result, what was reported a long time ago for a comparatively thick film of neodymium nickelate. So if you see concentrated in the metal phase, like at 190 Kelvin, you don't see any signature of nickel resonance. And as you are gradually entering into the insulating phase, you can see that this resonance signal that is gradually increasing. So from this experiment, they concluded that you have charge ordering in neodymium nickelate. So we are using the same technique. But now our samples are much, much thinner, so typically 5-6 nanometer. So the first thing what we wanted to check, whether this technique is suitable for in such ultra-thin film scale. So this is some resistivity data of europium nickelate, showing that it is insulating below 400 Kelvin. And we can see also that there is a signature of nickel resonance, confirming that, okay, charge ordering is also there in such thin samples. So now I will go back to this europium nickelate, lanthanum nickelate super lattice. So for analyzing the data, what I have defined also some kind of charge order parameter. So this is not an actual order parameter because this is not a thermodynamic quantity, but just for simplicity, I am defining this is my charge order parameter, like intensity, square root of the intensity minus square root of the background. Because my structure factor, intensity is proportional to the structure factor square. So that's why I'm taking square root. Okay. So this is the data results of one europium nickelate, one lanthanum nickelate samples. So this is the resistivity data as a function of temperature. So you can see that there is a metal insulator transition. And this is basically this charge order parameter, what I found from the experiment. And I have calculated that. And from the data, I have extracted this following this formula. So if you can see that at the same temperature where you have a metal insulator transition, there also your charge order parameter increases. So telling that there is a charge ordering in this one sample. Now, if I go back to the other sample, two europium nickelate, one lanthanum nickelate, where I predict that there will not be any charge ordering. So this is my experimental result. So this is again transport data. So it also shows a metal insulator transitions around 250 Kelvin, but the surprise is here. So if you compare, if you see that charge order parameter, it does not show any enhancement across the transition. And secondly, even in the metal phase, we can see the signature of charge ordering. So basically, what we are claiming or what we are observing, that even in the metal phase, it is a monoclinic in structure. That's why you are seeing this resonance. And secondly, across the transitions, there is no structural change, there is no charge ordering transitions. So these are the two major conclusions from this experiment. So basically, out of these four factors, then we can exclude that structural transition is not responsible and charge ordering transition is also not responsible for this metal insulator transition. So the question still remains, what happens to the magnetism? Does it also coincide with the metal insulator transitions? So let me briefly explain. Yeah. No, it's in-plane resistance. Yeah, from the top. So this is the antiferromagnetic ordering of rare earth nickelates. This is called E prime antiferromagnetic ordering. So if you look at these are 1-1-1 plane, so you can see the ordering is basically up, then you have a rotation of 90 degrees, then it's down, then another 90 degrees. So basically, this magnetic structure, you have a periodicity of 4. So you need to multiply 4 times your crystal structure to have the magnetic structures. So these structures were initially obtained from Newton diffraction, but for our thin film samples, Newton diffraction is not suitable. The signal is, you cannot see anything. So that's why you are using resonant soft X-ray scattering to see the magnetism. So the idea is that because in real space, you have a 4 multiplicity of 4, then you can go back to the reciprocal space and look at the peak, which are like quarter, quarter, quarter. So if you can see a quarter, quarter, quarter peak, that will tell you that there is this E prime magnetic ordering. So this is an example of an, again, europium nickelate thin film. So we can see this quarter, quarter, quarter peak at the very low temperature, at the low temperature, like 50 Kelvin. And if we measure this intensity of this peak as a function of temperature, then you will see that above certain temperature, this peak is no longer there. So from there, we can see that there is basically a transition from an antiferromagnetic insulator to a paramagnetic insulator. This is for pure europium nickelate. Now we did the same experiment for this again, these two super lattice. So for this 1-1, so this is the scattering intensity. This is soft excess scattering. So basically this is proportional to your magnetism, magnetic order parameter. So you can see that you also have a magnetic ordering at the same temperature as metal insulator transition. Basically for these samples, you have four transitions again simultaneously. But for the other samples, 2-1, where I have already showed that there is no charge ordering, there is no structural transition, we can found that this nil temperature is around 25 Kelvin lower. So this is around 245 Kelvin, and this nil temperature is 220 Kelvin. So then we can see that this magnetism is also not responsible for these samples, for this metal insulator transition. So then what is the origin of this metal insulator transition? So recently there are this gang of theorists, Mizukawa, Chomsky, Sawatsky, Millis. Then these people have predicted a different mechanism which is known as site-selective mode transition. I will go through it very briefly. So basically, if you count the number of electrons, so this nickelate is basically D7. So ionically, it's a S-half system. But these materials are negative charge transfer material. So there are basically one electron from the oxygen comes on nickel side. So basically, in reality, it is more like a D8. And L bar means you have hole on the oxygen. So the ground state is a mixture of D7 and D8 L bar. And the presence of D8 L bar, basically this ligand hole, has been confirmed by various experiments like X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, X-ray absorption spectroscopy, and also recently by resonant inelastic X-ray scattering. So then they predict that, okay, so for understanding this metal insulator transition, you can neglect this part of the wave function. So you can think that it is more like a D8 L bar system. So in the metal phase, every site is like a D8 L bar. But what is happening across the transitions, it's become more like a D8 and D8 L2 bar. So basically, this ligand hole from one oxygen is moving to another oxygen. So now if you see, so this D8, that is a S equals to 1 system. And D8 L2 bar, because you have S equals to 1 here, but also this ligand hole, that those are antiferromagnetically aligned with your nickel spin. So as a result, this D8 L2 bar, that's like a S equals to 0. So they describe this metal insulator transition as a bond disproportionation transition. So basically, you have a charge ordering on oxygen, but not on the nickel. This is their theoretical model. So we wanted to see whether we can see what is the spin value, whether it's a spin 1 or spin half. And then from there, we can get some intuition about the origin of this metal insulator transition. So in order to understand this magnetic moment, we did XMCD measurement, X-ray magnetic circular dichroism. So in this XMCD measurement, what you do basically, you have in this 3D transition metal oxides, your valence band consists of 3D bands. So if you pass an X-ray through your material, so when the energy is equal to the gap between 2P to 3D, then there will be a strong absorption. And if you do this experiment, and so this is the typical X-ray spectra for a copper. So now this line shape and the line position depends on the, gives you many crucial information. Like if you do this experiment with unpolarized X-ray, then the line shape will give you information about the charge state or valence state. If you do this experiment with linearly polarized X-ray, then this will tell you about orbital asymmetry or orbital ordering. And if you do the same experiment with circularly polarized light, then this difference in the absorption between left circular and right circular polarized X-ray is proportional to the magnetism. So we did these XMCD measurements. Now you can ask me that what is the meaning of a XMCD for an antiferromagnet? Because in principle, there should not be an XMCD for an antiferromagnet because the magnetization is zero. So what we did, so we apply a large magnetic field, like 5 Tesla, which was the highest magnetic field that one can apply in that beamline. So basically, we are canting the moment across the direction of the magnetic field, and then we are measuring the eccentricity. And that eccentricity now we have compared with well-known another compound like Ca2NiOSO6. This is a ferromagnet, and nickel is 2+. There is no complication of ligand hole or anything. Now, if you compare these two ligand, this line shape of eccentricity of these two compounds, you can clearly see that they are very similar. So from this experiment, we can see that that in this 2 europium nickelate, 1 lanthanum nickelate super lattice, this is more like a S equals to 1 like system. So basically, our magnetic structure is like that. So basically, you have a up spin, then a neck. So basically, this is like a D8. So the next 111 plane is D8 L2 bar. Again, this one is D8, and again, this is D8 L2 bar. So this is the magnetic structure. What we get from this measurement. So basically, from this measurement, we can tell that this metal insulator transitions is like a bond disproportionation transitions, and this is the mechanism. So once we have done this experiment and all of things, so we thought that we understood everything. But there are certain experimental results what we could not explain. So this is an old experimental data what is available in the literature regarding the Hall effect. So this is the basically Hall effect for prosodymium nickelate, PrNiO3. This compound also exhibits 4 simultaneous transitions in the bulk form. So this blue curve is the resistance as a function of temperature, and this one is basically the Hall coefficient. So you can see that in this paramagnetic metallic phase, your Hall coefficient is positive. But across the transitions, this Hall coefficient is becoming negative. So there is a switching of Hall coefficient across the transitions. But since there are 4 transitions together, so we don't know what is the origin. So we also did the similar Hall effect measurement on our thin film samples. So this is the Hall coefficient as a function of temperature. And because in these samples, we know that there is no charge ordering, there is no structural transitions, and also antiferromagnetic ordering happens little bit lower temperature compared to the metal insulator transition. So we can see that this Hall coefficient also changes sign, but it changes sign across the antiferromagnetic transitions. Okay, so we thought that whether this is just a coincidence, or let us see what happens to the other cases. So for that, we go back to this system neodymium nickelate. So in the neodymium nickelate, in the bulk form, it has 4 transitions together. But if you can grow thin film, and especially on the tensile strain, you can separate these transitions. Like you have a paramagnetic metal phase, paramagnetic insulating phase, and then antiferromagnetic insulating phase. So we measure this Hall effect on 2 thin film. One is neodymium nickelate on strontium titanate. So this is the strain, like 2.8%, and this is on neodymium gallate, the strain is plus 1.6%. So basically, the strain's values are different. So these lines denotes the metal insulator transitions, and this green one denotes the antiferromagnetic transitions. And these points are basically the signature of our measurement of Hall coefficient. Now, if you see in both cases, this switching happens from positive to negative across the antiferromagnetic transition, generally 10 Kelvin lower. Yeah, here also. Just below this magnetic transitions, your Hall coefficient becomes negative, while in the paramagnetic metallic phase, it's positive. So we are still struggling to understand why is this, but let me tell you our current understanding. So I will go back to the earlier literature. So people have done RFS, angle region photoemission spectroscopy on lanthanum nickelate. And from the RFS, they have showed that this Fermi surface consists of large hole pocket, and there are very small electron pocket. And also there are very important work was done by SungBin Lee, like around 5-6 years ago on these compounds. And what she showed, basically these are the Fermi surface, what she calculated in her paper, and she predicted this Fermi surface has large flat part in the Fermi surface. So basically, this whole Fermi surface has strong tendency for nesting. And this nesting vector is same as the E prime antiferromagnetic wave vector. And she predicted that this metal insulator transition is governed by this Fermi surface nesting. This was, so what we think that in this paramagnetic metallic phase, we have large hole pockets, so that's why you are getting positive Hall coefficient. And in this antiferromagnetic insulating phase, basically those hole pockets are no longer there, they are nested, and there are small, small electron pockets, so that's why we are getting RAs as negative in this antiferromagnetic insulating phase. Then the problem what we are still struggling, that how this Fermi surface is surviving in this paramagnetic insulating phase. Because if it is an insulator, then there should not be any Fermi surface. So what we think that this metal insulator transitions or bond disproportionation transition, that is actually giving a partially gapped Fermi surface. So this transition doesn't create gap in all directions of the Fermi surface. So we have a partially gapped Fermi surface in this paramagnetic insulating phase. And once we have these antiferromagnetic transitions, then these hole pockets are no longer there. And Hall effect is contributed by these small electron pockets. So this is our current understanding. But I must say that complementary experiment like temperature-dependent angle-resolved photoemission spectroscopy is really required to understand all of this phenomena, especially this thing. So last 10 minutes, I will. So basically, these are the conclusion from this first part of my talk, that this for rare earth nickelate, you can get metal insulator transitions without any charge ordering and symmetry lowering. And this bond disproportionation phase basically gives you a pseudo gap phase. And selective suppression of cooperative ordering is possible by this heterostructures route. So the last 10 minutes, I will talk slightly a different topic, which is known as geometrical lattice engineering. So basically, whether you can generate artificial symmetry, like this is a Kagome lattice, whether you can engineer this kind of structure using this heterostructure. So we all know that structures and property, they are very correlated with each other. So the most common examples is the difference between a graphite and diamond. Though both are carbon, they have different structures and properties are completely different. Now coming back to the oxides, if you consider this barium ruthenic, BaRuO3, so in normal temperature and pressure, it will stabilize into this 9-layer rhombohedral phase, and this is Pauli paramagnetic. But if you synthesize under very high oxygen pressure, then it becomes a cubic, and this cubic phase is basically a ferromagnetic. So basically, if you can engineer your lattice, then you can also generate new kind of electronic and magnetic phenomena. So this was a theoretical work predicted by several theorists that actually one can generate new kind of lattice, and in that lattice one can get actually new topological phase. So this was simply like this is a ABO3 perovskite lattice. Now if you look at the ABO3 perovskite lattice along 111 direction, and if you consider just 2111 plane, then your structure will look like this. So basically, this is a buckled honeycomb lattice. So there are lots of work over the last 5-6 years. There are two beautiful review articles on the theory aspect. And there are many predictions that this kind of geometrical lattice engineering can give you quantum anomalous Hall effect in perovskite oxides. So we also did a lot of experiment on this topic, and we also wrote an experimental review article on this. So we also did the same thing, this geometrical lattice engineering for rare earth nickelate. I'm not going into the details of the results, but what we found, that this is from experiment and this is from theory, that in this graphene-like geometry, this rare earth nickelate shows antiferro orbital ordering. So if you look at this bulk phase diagram, there is no orbital order. But when you synthesize this buckled honeycomb lattice of rare earth nickelate, it actually becomes antiferro orbital ordering. So this shows that geometrical lattice engineering is another way to engineer your ground state of your systems. So this concept of geometrical lattice engineering, you can also apply for spinel. Like if you look AB2O4 spinel along 111 direction, it actually consists of the following. You have Kagome plane, tangular and triangular. So if you can see that if you can just grow one unit cell, then you will have one Kagome layer and three triangular layer. But experimentally, these are very challenging. So in my previous group, there was one PhD student who has done his PhD on his topic. So basically, he has grown this cobalt chromate spinel along 111 direction. So cobalt chromate is ferrimagnet with a transition temperature around 90 Kelvin. So what is showed that if you can just grow one unit cell of cobalt chromate, basically you have this only four plane, then there is no long-range magnetic ordering, and there are signatures that these systems actually become a spin liquid. So this is basically another new route that you can stabilize geometrically fastened lattice artificially. Similarly, if you take a pyrochlore lattice, Re2A2B2O7, and if you consider along 111 direction also, this pyrochlore lattice is also consist of alternating Kagome-triangle plane. So you can also see that now using this heterostructure route, probably one can just grow one unit cell. Then you will have just an isolated Kagome plane. Generally, it's very difficult to experimentally realize Kagome lattice, but this heterostructure route can be a new thing to generate artificially frustrated systems. So there are a lot of some experimental work by Kawasaki group from Riken. So they have grown these different kinds of iridates, Re2IR2O7, along 111 direction. But so far, there is no success of just growing one unit cell. So many groups are trying. We are also trying. But so far, we are unsuccessful in this. But we hope that one day that we will be able to synthesize just one layer of such Kagome-triangle, and this will give a new way to engineer materials. So finally, I would like to conclude my talk that complex materials basically show interesting electronic and magnetic phenomena, and interface engineering is to disentangle simultaneous transitions, and this geometrical lattice engineering can be a new way to engineer topological phase and frustrated magnetism. Thank you.
So regarding this slide, so you exclude the possibility of the charge ordering, and instead you propose the bond ordering. Could you explain what is the bond ordering?
Okay. So this is the, so you have a D8 L bar in the metal phase, everything is D8 L bar. So across the transitions, what is happening, half of the sides, it's becoming D8, and half of the sides is becoming D8 L2 bar. So basically, the holes on the oxygen, that is moving from one oxygen to another oxygen. So now, this D8, that has a longer bond, and D8 L2 bar, that has a shorter bond.
Okay, so
that's why they are calling as a bond disproportionation.
Okay,
so here, on every side, your bond lengths are same, but here they are not same.
I see. So, but is there any, let's say, experimental evidence for this kind of the bond ordering? Okay. So it's kind of the charge ordering at the oxygen side.
Yeah.
Okay.
So from the experiment, one should do resonance scattering on the oxygen, but that is very difficult. So that geometry is not allowed to see that thing.
So before your Hall switches, it always sort of sharply tries to go up.
Yeah.
Do you have some understanding for that?
Not at the moment.
It seems to happen at the metal insulator.
Metal insulator transition, it increases slightly.
Always.
Then it starts to decrease.
Okay. Thank you.
Any more questions? Actually, I have a question.
Yeah.
So if you go back in your slides,
yeah,
this go back this where you have this charge disproportionality.
Okay.
The other figure, this stacking.
Okay. So maybe the previous one. Yeah, this one.
No, this one. This one stacking.
Oh, that is anti ferromagnetic ordering. Okay.
Disproportion. So you have another figure of this, right?
Yeah.
Can you go to the other figure?
Yeah. So basically what we, so in this figure,
yeah,
this was the original model,
yeah,
where they predict that nickel spin is there on each nickel side. But once you have this bond disproportion, so then some of the sides, the spin is zero, S equals to zero.
And this is non-magnetic, right?
This is antiferromagnetic.
You are saying this is some of them has no spin, right?
Yeah, so those sides alternating become S equals to zero.
Yeah, it is non-magnetic.
Those planes are non-magnetic.
Yeah, so it's a stacking of, you know, it's almost a decoupled in a sense. Decoupled layer of spin one local moments on a triangle lattice.
This is...
Can you go to the latter slide? You have another figure of that.
Okay. I think it's here. Yeah.
Yeah, this one, yeah.
Yeah, yeah.
So if you are just visualize along this plane, it's, yeah, so this layer would be a triangle lattice. Is it a triangle lattice?
It's a 1-1-1 plane, so it's...
That is a triangle lattice.
But there are coupling with oxygen, which I have not shown. So this nickel is also interacting with this nickel by oxygen.
Yeah, this is high order effects. Mm-hmm. So are you sure it's this kind of ice in collinear, any collinear carbon magnetic order here?
Yeah, yeah, that's right.
Despite its triangle lattice.
Yeah, but these triangular lattices, these are also connected with each other. Mm-hmm. They are not isolated triangles.
Okay, okay. Yeah, thanks. So if there is no question, let's thank the speaker again. Okay.